Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
For all of you in the room and all of you that are online, it is a beautiful day to be in here. If you got here for Sunday school, you came in a torrential downpour. But it's going to be glorious out there in just a little while and humid. It'll be humid this afternoon for the Pride Parade, which will be a lot of fun, but it will also be beautiful about the time we finish worship and we go outside for baptisms on the patio. So today, let us gather together, let us stand, and let us sing as we worship our God. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. I can feel God's mighty power and grace. We can hear the brush of angels' wings. We see glory on each face. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. Spirit, Spirit of gentleness, blow through the wilderness, calling and free. Spirit, Spirit of restlessness, stir me from placidness, wind on the sea. You moved on the rush of the wind. Spirit, Spirit of gentleness, flow through the wilderness, calling and freeing. Spirit, Spirit of restlessness, stir me from placidness. Call from tomorrow, you break ancient schemes. From the bondage of sorrow, your captives dream dreams. Are women see visions, are men clear their eyes with bold new decisions. Your people arise. Spirit, Spirit of gentleness, flow through the wilderness, calling and freeing. Spirit, Spirit of restlessness, stir me from placidness. You may be seated.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome, welcome. We're so glad you're here with us today, whether you're in the room or whether you're online. We're very glad you're here. Today is the day of Pentecost, when we remember how God gave us the gift of the Holy Spirit. It happened after Jesus went away. The people of God were in Jerusalem to celebrate the Great Thanksgiving called Pentecost. They came from every country. Jesus' friends were in Jerusalem too. They were still waiting for the gift God promised to send, the gift of the Holy Spirit. Suddenly, a sound like a mighty rushing wind filled the whole room. And what looked like flames of fire came to rest on them. And they were filled with the Holy Spirit. They were so excited. They began to tell the amazing things that God did. They told about Jesus. The people from all different countries came and they told how Jesus was raised from the dead. And all the people from all the different countries could understand them. They heard in their own language. What should we do? They asked. And Peter said, change your ways. Be baptized. You will be washed clean and new, and you will receive the Holy Spirit. God's promise for you and for your children, and for everyone God calls. Now, I wonder how Jesus' friends felt as they told about the amazing things that God had done. I wonder what all of these people will do now that they have the gift of the Holy Spirit. I wonder what the Holy Spirit wants us to do with God's gifts. Let's say a prayer, hands together in our laps, heads down. Dear God, thank you for the gift of the Holy Spirit. Help us to use it in the way you'd want.
Help us to use it in the way you want.
In Jesus' name we pray.
In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
We live in a time of struggle, a time of disconnection and division. But here's what the Apostle Paul has to say to God's people who are struggling. We are hard-pressed on every side, but not crushed, perplexed, but not driven to despair, persecuted, but not abandoned, struck down, but not destroyed. We carry around in our bodies the death of Jesus, so that the life of Jesus may also be revealed in our bodies. God is an ever-present help in times of struggle. God's love is steadfast. And new life is being revealed in our new churches. We're growing, we're praying, we're praising, we're serving. We're a rainbow of different colors. We're a symphony of 28 different languages and counting. We're turning struggle into steadfastness, revealing the life of Jesus in our bodies, in our neighborhoods, and in our hearts. My name is Rebecca Anderson, and I'm one of the pastors of Gilead Church Chicago. Thanks to the ongoing support of the New Church movement of the Christian Church, Disciples of Christ, we've been able to throw great parties and make real friends, make beautiful, creative worship, and tell true stories that save lives. We live in a time of struggle, and even more, we live in a time of God's steadfast love and justice. Therefore, my beloved, be steadfast, immovable, always excelling in the work of God, because we know that in God our labor is never in vain.
The Pentecost offering goes towards new church starts. It also goes towards revitalizing churches that have fallen to the wayside, and some of them close, and some of them, like us, find new life. So today, I ask that you give towards the Pentecost offering, that you give towards our ministries here at this church. Let us receive our morning offering as we hear Julianne sing, "Every Time I Hear the Spirit."
As we gather, kindle our souls, our broken pieces becoming whole. A new beginning, a brand new day, bring us together in every way. Every time I feel the Spirit moving in my heart, I will pray. Oh, every time I feel the Spirit moving in my heart, I will pray. When we fall short, God, to do what's right, guide us swiftly back to the light. Let peace and justice together reign. Let all the faithful catch Spirit's flame. Every time I feel the Spirit moving in my heart, I will pray. Oh, every time I feel the Spirit moving in my heart, I will pray.
Right.
this is your dance break.
As loving people, help us to share your power and presence everywhere. Let justice roll down and righteousness, like flowing water, be in our midst. Every time I feel the Spirit moving in my heart, I will pray. Oh, every time I feel the Spirit moving in my heart, I will pray. Yes, every time I feel the Spirit moving in my heart, I will pray. Oh, every time I feel the Spirit moving in my heart, I will pray. I will pray. I will pray.
Speaking of praying, here comes Tom.
Yay! I'm late to the prayer. Yep. We had to harmonize. Sometimes we even hit the right part. All right, let us bow in prayer together. Lord, let us recognize together in this special time that this is a significant moment in our church calendar, in the story of our faith. Let us recognize your Spirit. Let us be in the Spirit of God, and let us recognize that the Spirit of God is in us. And may we respond to that Spirit to do and to say things that will be in accordance with your loving will, to make this a better world in which to live, and to bring other people to greater acts of faith and deliverance. Lord, we thank you for baptisms today, one of the things we're looking forward to. And we thank you for the rain that has come, perhaps a bit inconveniently, but nonetheless much needed. We pray, God, that we might together seek in your Spirit, the kingdom of God and its righteousness. And we seek these things in the name of our Savior Jesus Christ, he who taught us to pray as now we sing.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place. And without warning, there was a sound like a mighty wind, and it filled the whole building. I can't imagine a wind in a building. And then, to top that off, they saw what looks like tongues of fire moving in all directions in the room, and a tongue came and settled on each person. How weird. The Holy Spirit took control of them, and they began speaking in other languages as the Spirit led them. Now, at that time, it was the festival of the Pentecost, so of course there were devout Jews of every nation in Jerusalem. And when they heard the noise, a crowd started to gather. But they were surprised because they were hearing everything in each their own language. They were excited and amazed and said, "Aren't all these people Galileans? Why do we hear them in our own language? For there were Parthians and Medes and Elamites and residents of Mesopotamia and Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs, all in their own languages they were hearing them speaking about God's mighty deeds and power." Everyone was excited and confused. Some of them kept asking each other, "What does this mean?" Others made fun of them and said, "Ha, they're drunk." Upon hearing this, Peter couldn't take that. So Peter stands up and he says in a clear, loud voice, "Friends, listen. Listen to what I have to say. You're wrong. These people aren't drunk. It's only 9 in the morning." But this is what God told the prophet Joel. "When the last days come, I will give my spirit to everyone. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see visions, and your old men will dream dreams. In those days, I will give my spirit to my servants, both men and women, and they will prophesy. I will work miracles in the sky above and wonders on the earth below. There will be blood and fire and clouds of smoke. The sun will turn dark and the moon will be red as blood before the great and wonderful day that the Lord appears. Then the Lord will save everyone who asks for help." The word of the Lord for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Go ahead. Feel free to sing along, get up, dance, whatever you feel.
Living with my eyes closed, going day to day. I never knew the difference. I never cared either way. Looking for a reason, searching for a sign. Reaching out with both hands, I gotta feel the kick inside. All fired up, all fired up, all fired up, all fired up, fired up, fired up. Hey! Ain't nobody living in a perfect world. Everybody's out there crying to be heard. But now I got a new fire burning in my eyes, lighting up the darkness, moving like a meteorite. All fired up, hey! All fired up, yeah! Now I believe there comes a time when everything just falls in line. We live Now I believe there comes a time when everything just falls in line. We live and learn from our mistakes. The deepest cuts are healed by faith. Now I believe there comes a time when everything just falls in line. We live and learn from our mistakes. Yeah. Now I believe there comes a time when everything just falls in line. We live and learn from our mistakes. The deepest cuts are healed by faith. Now I believe. Oh, fired up. Come on. Oh, fired up. Oh, fired up. Oh, fired up, fired up, fired up. Now I believe there comes a time when everything just
rock and roll, folks, rock and roll.
Sometime while I was in college is when Pat Benatar came out with that song. It's been a few years. 1988. She wasn't even born. But that refrain, I kept thinking about Pentecost, and now I believe there comes a time, all fired up, when everything just falls in line, all fired up. We live and learn from our mistakes. The deepest cuts are healed by faith. You know, we didn't even have to change the words. Those are the exact words that Pat Benatar sang. This is not one of Tom's parody songs. Pat Benatar's words have a way of piercing your soul with such truth when you need to be reminded that no matter what we're facing, how hard life seems to be, the arc of God's love continues to unfold. These past weeks, I've been working with these amazing kids in this pastor's class, in this discipleship class, and it got me thinking about what does Pentecost mean in 2022? I mean, we're living in a world that's still reeling from a pandemic. We're dealing with mass shootings. I saw there was one again this morning. We've got a world war looming, it seems. And Pat Benatar's song sings out to our souls again. We are in a world with deep, deep cuts right now, trying to reignite faith. And even though we're back in person and online at the same time, people are exhausted with trying to relearn what it means to be community. And we get impatient, and sometimes we seem, well, disengaged from one another. And if I'm totally honest, you know, what do we do this with this God who kindles fire for us in times such as these? And so, Pentecost. On that original day of Pentecost, this motley group of disciples were so impassioned with their sudden empowerment for mission that people thought they were tipsy. The disciples themselves were probably pretty odd with themselves, the fact that they could speak to, and by the way, I'm sure I butchered these the first time and I'm going to butcher them again this time. Parthians and Medes and Elamites, Iranians. Mesopotamians, Iraqis. Cappadocians and people from Pontus, Pamphylia, and Phrygia, varieties of Turkish people, Asians, and people from Libya and Cyrene, Africans, not to mention the Romans. This is the known world at the time of Jesus in the early church. Well, there really was no church yet. This was the birth of a movement, maybe, but even after Pentecost, it really wasn't a church as we think about churches today. But these crazy disciples preach to an international crowd, and everybody understood what they were saying. You know, the miracle would take them further from their known world than they would ever expect to travel. I mean, the obvious miracle was that they were able to speak about Jesus in a way that attracted people of different cultures and tongues into somewhat of a shared faith. But the greater miracle was that they were becoming a community of genuinely diverse people. Men and women from every culture known at the time were coming together in community, a diverse community of love and service. And so that brings us back to us. Disciples First Christian Church in the year 2022. What do we do with all of this spirit language, all of this fire language, and God forbid speaking in tongue language? I mean, it's kind of sci-fi green screen freakishness. What does it mean for us now? What's it all about? What is the Spirit's fire? Is it a fire that burns and burns and burns and never goes out? Is it more like an Olympic torch that we bear and then share with somebody else? Or is it a flicker that only ignites when we notice it or make sure that it's not being drowned out by something else, that we have to take care of it? Whatever it is, I don't think it's a reasonable or explainable or rational even. Which is why when we hear the story of Acts 2, we have to make sure we don't forget what was said in Acts 1. In the 8th verse of Acts 1, here's the knowledge you need. You will receive the power of the Holy Spirit. And you will be my witnesses, first here in Jerusalem, then beyond to Judea and Samaria. Samaria, really? And finally to the farthest places of the earth. That glorious phrase that keeps us fired up when all is burnt, when we are exhausted, which many of us are, when we are unsure where to place our energies next. Because guess what? We aren't spectators in the story of Pentecost. We are the sharers of God's love. We are the ones who start right where we are in this special place on this earth in which we live, here in Oklahoma, and move out from here. So the question is, how do we recapture the embers? How do we keep the fire going? What stories of God with us give us the energy and remind us that we don't do this work by ourselves, but in community? As Kristen used to sing all the time growing up, we're all in this together. But then what? We know that we're in it together. What do we do now? Then we have to share the stories that have touched our lives. We share God's fire because it glows for some. For some people, they just have a spark. And then, you know, there are those that are flaming all the time. And God will light the way. I asked some of the kids from the discipleship class to answer the question, what gets you fired up about coming to church? What gets you excited about coming to church? Here's a few of their answers.
I'm excited to come to church because of the worshiping and the praying that we do here. and the community service that we do, like last Saturday, we went and fed the homeless. And I'm excited to come to church because they feed us good here. And that's pretty much it.
My favorite part about the church is the friendly faces I get to see. That's what probably gets me out of bed on Sunday. And probably the fact that I get to get out of the house and just sing songs and stuff, you know?
Okay. The reason that I like to come to church is because of Miss Carol's awesome cooking on Wednesdays and being in Miss Carol's classroom on Sundays. And worshiping and singing songs. That's kind of it.
Very good.
Good. So they answered the question. So I'm asking you, what gets you fired up about our congregation? What ministries have energy? What mission projects have people smiling? What lives have been changed because of our church? And this is not a rhetorical question. I actually want to hear from people. So I'm getting a microphone. Anyone? You have germs, so you can't?
I like to see all my friends and family, and I like performing music with everybody.
Thank you.
I like this congregation and this church because although we may not all get along together, we will all reach out and take care of each other. And I'm learning what it means to love everyone.
James?
No surprise, but the Jewel Box Theater is what really gets me going because it gives me an opportunity to share what God's given me, the talent he's given me, and make people laugh, make them cry, and make them think.
I like it because I sometimes forget I'm at church. I'm just with friends and family, and I look forward to seeing them every week like I would any other friend or family. Yep.
I just shocked him.
Closer.
I love coming to church because, like Raylene said, you're family. And I think we care about each other. We want to make sure that each other is okay and that we are trying to take care of everybody. I love cooking for you all. And I love decorating this place, this space for you all to appreciate and for God's glory.
And Meredith just said from home, because of the positive people, the love and caring, the discipleship and action.
Gonna do one more. Carol, what she does with the children, the fact that we now have, we get to be with them every week, whereas before it was only a special time. I love that we get to see her spirit and her love and her joy come through every week. Mm-hmm.
One more online. I'm not sure who this is, but the acceptance of everyone. Oh, it's Betty. Okay, anyone else?
I got one. I like the fact that it's not always the same. We have surprises.
What does same mean?
Like your music?
Yeah, that's one. Or like our internet not working.
I love coming to this church because I feel accepted no matter what. And I feel like anybody else can have that feeling if they just come be with us.
No, should I be scared?
Yeah, always. Yeah. This is actually true. I like, it's not, the like isn't the word. It's about being fired up. What makes me fired up about this church is that we have so much work to do. We are struggling so much. We are struggling financially. We are struggling spatially. We are struggling socially. We're struggling politically. And we continue to struggle. And we have work to do, and we come here and we do the work.
Mm-hmm. I made a list earlier in case some things didn't get mentioned. Did everybody see this sign here? Everyone is different, everyone belongs. I like the fact that everyone belongs. Did you want to say something? I didn't even turn around and look. Okay. I like the fact that all means all. I like the fact that, and I'm going to miss the Wednesday dinners, but we're done until right after Labor Day because of summer. But I like getting together on Wednesdays. I liked these last 6-7 weeks working with this amazing group of kids who were coming up with better answers than the adults who were sitting in the room, and the adults will attest to that. It was very incredible. And Refuge Fellowship, we went out and we fed the homeless with the kids a couple weeks ago, and we'll be back on a regular basis doing that again. And the bicycles. I think the bicycle ministry has changed thousands of lives in Oklahoma City. You know, we have had this amazing past as First Christian Church of Oklahoma City. And, you know, started in 1889 and the oldest church in the city, along with the Baptists, the Presbyterians, and the Methodists, who all started on the same day. But we have an amazing future still. The fire is not gone, but it has to continue to be kindled. We have to continue doing the work. We have to continue, as Anna put it, struggling every week to make it happen. The Spirit is ablaze in this room, people. You can feel it. I'm excited about the baptisms today, but we also have the potential for being a place of healing for those people who have been torn apart by churches. There are people out there who have said, I'm never going back to a church ever again because of the way I was treated. And church doesn't have to be that way, but people have to be led in that direction in a very gentle way and not hit over the head. Because if you hit them over the head, you're just hurting them again. We are disciples of Jesus Christ, a movement for wholeness in a fragmented world. Whoever figured out that turn of phrase was brilliant, because that's the world we live in, a world that is torn apart and fragmented and hurting. And we can't solve every problem out there, but we can do our little part here. And we can share the spirit of love in this world. Recapture the spirit of how God unleashes love and life in different forms, not volcanic all the time. Sometimes a slow burn is better. Activate your imagination so that we can begin to recognize how God is working within us. From our doorsteps, with hope and mercy and justice and life and love, we are disciples first, followers in the way of Jesus, because once we have been touched by the fire, We are bringers and sharers of God's spirit of love. It's our call. It's our mission to go and love all the people. It only takes a spark. It only takes a spark to get a fire going. And soon all those around can warm up in its glowing. That's how it is with God's love. Once you've experienced it, you spread God's love to everyone. You want to pass it on. Amen. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Melt me, mold me. Acapella.
Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me.
Come to this table because the Spirit of God has fallen afresh on us. When I listen to you all sing, when I feel the Spirit raised in this room, when I look at your faces while I'm preaching, and those of you that aren't asleep, no, seriously though, you know how easy it is to preach in a room like this where you know people are listening and you know people are thinking about what you've said, and sometimes they're going, and that's okay too. But God's Spirit joins us here, especially at this table, when we remember bread broken, when we remember cup poured. And we remember lives changed. So as we take bread together, we're getting good at shaking these people. And drinking the cup together. Let us remember the fire that is within us, that when put together with the rest of the fire in the room, can change the world. Let us spend some time in prayer as we continue to feel God's presence.
Thank you.
As you can see, there's an adult standing beside each child because we went through this class together. They each had a sponsor that they were able to interview about their sponsor's baptism and other things along the way. So I'm going to send these people in to start getting robes on. And in just a moment, we are going to go out to the patio. We have a portable hot tub set up as a portable baptistry, and we're going to do the baptistries right out there in just a moment. I'd like for us just to give them this much time. Let's sing the last verse of the last song.
The third one? Yeah, there we go.
I wish for you, my friend, this happiness that I found. On God you can depend, it matters not where you're bound. Come to me, I want to pass it on.
James fell and still got the next to the last slide done.
We love you, okay? James.
My son did it. Okay. Let us go from this place with a song in our hearts, sharing God's love with everyone we meet, and let us go witness the joy of baptism.